Jacob Bressels at Peniel. The same that starts on verse 22. The same night he got up and took his two wives, his two maids, and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of Jephthah. He took them and sent them across the stream, and likewise everything that he had. Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he struck him on the hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day is breaking." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then the man said, "You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved." The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping because of his hip. Therefore, to this day, the Israelites do not eat the thigh muscle that is on the hip socket, because he struck Jacob on the hip socket at the thigh muscle. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, as we study Genesis this morning, there is so much that we can learn about Jacob and our walk with you. There are many times that we wrestle with you, but you are always there by our side. Be with us now, in Jesus' name. Amen. One of the sports that I really disliked in high school was wrestling. I just hated it. There was a little room that had padding on the floor, padding on the sides. And I just hated that sport. I liked other sports, but that was one sport that I just didn't like, wrestling. You know, wrestling is a very popular sport throughout the country and throughout the world. There are many things that they have with wrestling, with thumb wrestling and other sorts. But I remember when I went to Elysburg in 1980, in August of that year, the new appointment was in the first Sunday in July, and I was new to the town, our family was new. They had a town weekend where they had barbecue and they had games and they had speakers coming. Well, this one particular year, the town council decided they were going to have lady wrestlers and sell tickets on a Saturday night. Well, I'll tell you, being new to the town, the churches were mad, the women were mad. Lady wrestlers coming into our town, what have we become? Well, it was canceled. No lady wrestlers. They had to bring in some band that nobody knew to play that Saturday night. But you know, there's many times when we look at wrestling that we wrestle within our own life. There are times when we wrestle with God or with circumstances that we have. And as we look at our scripture lesson this morning, we see an individual named Jacob. And Jacob is a twin with Esau. Esau is the oldest, so that means that the father will give everything to him. And from a very early age, it's even saying in some scriptures that when he was in the womb, that he wrestled with his brother, his older brother. He was the type of guy that wanted to be first. He was the kind of guy that wanted to be recognized. And so what he did, his mother and he tricked the father into giving the blessing to Jacob. Esau was left out. Well, after that happened, Jacob took off for 20 years. He was afraid that his brother would come and kill him. But after 20 years, they came together, and he knew his brother was going to come, and he had like 400 soldiers with him to meet Jacob. And he thought, my brother's going to kill me, but his brother, instead of killing him, embraced him and kissed him, welcomed him back. So, you know, I forgive you. Well, what began to happen as a result is that Jacob, prior to that, was fearful. And so they said that in a dream, he is wrestling with someone, and in this particular dream, it's an angel, representative of God. And so this wrestling match goes on and on and on, and finally, because it was kind of like a tie, Jacob's hip muscle was broken, and he's limping. And then finally he said, let me go. I just want to end this wrestling match, the angel is saying. And he says, well, what's your name? Give me your name. I want a blessing. And so he gets a blessing from God. And what we begin to see, and then Jacob says, well, what is your name? He says, well, what is your name? He said, my name is Jacob. He said, you're going to be called Israel from now on. What is happening is that Jacob is at that part of the land in the Middle East that's going to become part of Israel. And the blessing is that your future generation will grow with the Jewish people. You will be the promised land. You will be the promised people. Well, it's also interesting, therefore, to this day, the Israelites do not eat the thigh muscle that is on the hip socket, because he struck Jacob on the hip socket at the thigh muscle. That's part of being kosher. They won't eat that as part of their meal. They'll just let that go. But there's a lot to learn from this lesson today. When we begin to look at our own lives, how many times have we wrestled with an issue? Maybe finances or a relationship or family matters, we wrestle. And what we begin to see is that God is always with us. Even with Jacob limping and walking like this, he realizes that God is with him. You see, for Jacob, his future was rooted in fear. He was fearful of the future, so he tried to do everything in his life to make things go his way, even if he had to cheat or lie or do something. All these things that are there. It is in wrestling that we confront what it means to trust God with our life. A lot of times we feel that we are alone, that there's no one with us. And so we wrestle with our thoughts, with anxiety. And we do have a mental crisis thing going on in our country and in our world. Mental illness is there. And so we struggle. And we say, well, this is going to happen, and this is going to be the outcome. And many times it never happens at all. This wrestling with God. There's a true story of a man whose wife was very ill. And he didn't want to go to church. He just wanted to kind of withdrew to himself. And then he did go to church. And as he walked out, he looked and whispered, God is good. And God is good, and being God. It was interesting, as I was working on my sermon this past week, and late afternoon I went to a local coffee shop and was working on my sermon. And there was a young person there, about 30 years of age, looking at the laptop and crying, just holding their head like this. And this went on for a little bit. Everyone was looking, didn't know what to do. And finally I got up and I walked over and I said, excuse me, my name is Ken. Is there anything I can do? Are you going to be okay? And the person looked up and with tears in their eyes and said, I got bad news, but I'm glad that someone came over. And then what happened is, my result of going over, two other people got up from their coffee and went over as well and said, if you need anything, let us know and we'll be there for you. Let that person know that they're not alone in their struggle. And then finally, as they began to leave, there was sort of this new identity that came over the person, that they were able to smile and said, I think everything will be okay. I think everything will be okay. And then the story of Jacob teaches us that there are blessings we can only gain through our times with wrestling with God. There are times when we have to wrestle with God. And in that wrestle, God will be there for us to uplift us. Can you imagine Jesus going into Jerusalem, knowing that prophecy said that you have to give your life? Going to that cross was a major crisis. And Jesus said, you know, Father, do I really have to go through this? And he realizes, yes, this was God's plan. But you see, through Jacob, by that suffering that he had, it's also opening the way. He said, your name will be Israel, for future generations from David on down to trace their heritage to Jesus Christ. As a result of that injury, as a result of that wrestling with God. And finally, it is when we meet God in our weakness and God prevails, we gain God's strength. That is when God can use us and work through us to accomplish God's will. And finally, his world shifted and God was there with him. You see, it was not in silence that we often find God, but in fighting. Why did this have to happen? It doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense. And it is through this fighting that we find our relationship with God. I don't know if you're experiencing your own wrestling match now, a time when you wrestle with God. Maybe you're wrestling with giving control of some part of your life. Maybe you're wrestling with the question of God's goodness, God's love for you, God's plan for your life. What is your plan for my life, Lord? I hope that you will hang on in the wrestling, to wrestle with it. I hope that you will keep your eyes and ears open for God's presence and receive God's blessing in the struggle. And I hope you trust that when you meet God in your weakness, God will provide more than enough strength to sustain you. And then you'll discover in your wrestling, you're not alone. You're not alone. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, that is the purpose of the Christian faith, the mission of the church. To spread the message that we are not alone. And in that struggling and that wrestling match, we can feel your presence. Even if it means that we might have to break a hip bone and struggle with that. But finally, we find you in our life. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Turn to page 12, when we have Holy Communion, let us remember 2,000 years ago when Jesus met with his disciples in the upper room, a time of a meal, a time of laughter, a time of sharing their thoughts. He knew that not everyone was on his side. He knew that he would be betrayed, that he would be denied. Even three times. Oh, Lord, no, Lord, I am not going to deny you. That's what happened. And so as we begin the invitation this morning, let us think that we are sitting at that supper with the Lord. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin, and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another.
Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
There is good news. Hear the good news, because Christ has died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are all forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen.
And now we enter into the great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you,
and also with you.
We lift up our hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of the suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. Who in the same night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you and broke the bread and gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ offered for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ and one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, and with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now once again, with the confidence of children of God, let us pray the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The body of Christ given for you. Amen. blood of Christ given for you, amen. At this time, Brendan will play.
This is another Clementi Sonata, it's number 2, and I'll get through all 3 movements in less than 5 minutes.